My man Junior on the motherfucking beat with some straight up heat.
Kush A Show. Kush A Show. The Kush A Show.
The Kush A Show.
Microdose.
What's good, y'all? Kush Hayes here, coming to you. New episode of the Microdose. Robyn Seto, how you doing today?
Great.
That's it.
You're coming to us on location. You're currently calling us from a car. Where are you reporting from? Downtown Baghdad.
I'm Ivory in. Coast. Yeah, I'm out on the cliffs of Dover.
Cliffs of Dover. My word.
That's
a lot of machine gun fire in the background still.
Yeah, you may hear some machine guns that sound a lot like car alarms. So don't worry about it.
All right. Robyn, we got a new thing here on the Microdose. First time we've ever done this. We got a guest with us. Michael Bajer, coming to us with the One More Story Before 12 podcast. It's on YouTube. Mike, how you doing?
I'm doing just fine. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for being on part of this, man. One More Story Before 12. I like the title. I like the way you say it in the show. Tell us about the meaning behind the story and the show itself.
Sure, absolutely. Well, One More Story Before 12 is a true crime podcast that hopes to kind of shed light on these kind of more obscure cases that have kind of been lost to time and that people don't really talk about. And the name itself, One More Story Before 12, comes from the Carpenter film, The Fog, which is one of my favorite films.
All right.
And it comes from my favorite scene, actually, in the film is the opening, the first 5 minutes where they're all sitting around the campfire and they're hearing the story of, you know, the ship crashing into the rocks and that, you know, when the fog rolls back into town, so they'll rise. And I wanted to capture that kind of ghostly feeling around that fireplace, you know, hearing like a creepy story around the campfire. It just stuck with me so much as a kid that I decided to kind of give back and name my podcast after that one line.
It really bleeds into the show too. Like, it's a fun aspect of the show. Just the entire time you're just telling the story. You're just laying down the facts. And meanwhile, there's just a snapple and this pop going on in the background. And you feel like you're at the campfire. You feel like the only thing that's missing is maybe some cocoa and some s'mores. It's a creepy good time.
It's great for, you know, if you're doing other stuff. There's creepy images, but it's
yeah, the entire time, like, you're running a slideshow during the it's a good visual. You're currently talking about The Beast of Jersey. It's currently a three-parter. The first two parts are out. I've only seen part one. Tell us a little bit about The Beast of Jersey as opposed to The Jersey Devil.
The Beast of Jersey came about in a kind of interesting way. One time on the internet, I just found this very creepy picture of this mask and this wig and like these nail studded cloth thingies around an arm. And I thought, my God, this is creepy, because it reminded me of all those old vintage Halloween costumes that you'd see from the 1920s or the 1930s. And I said, all right, well, I got to find out. You know, I wasn't expecting to find out anything about it. I thought, it's just some costume somebody made and there wasn't going to be much to it. But by happy coincidence, I found out about a man called Edward Paynell, who was a serial rapist and by all accounts, probably a murderer too, even though that was never proven in court. And the more I read about this story, you know, it was like something straight out of a horror novel, the way he would dress up breaking into homes wearing this getup. And Hollywood looked at this and said, hey, this is ripe for exploitation, you know, let's get this onto the big screen. And I started digging into it, and a lot of the books that I had to get on the subject matter are old and all out of print, written in the 70s. His wife, even at the time, wrote a book about him. And it turns out he led a very kind of strange, bizarre double life. On one hand, he was a very much pillar of the community, respected and admired by a lot of individuals on the island and viewed as a sort of, you know, trustworthy man who would dress up as Santa Claus and go to the kids and give out gifts. On the other hand, he would put on this get up and, you know,
is Silent Night Deadly Night based on this guy? Innocent question. I'm sorry if that seems silly.
Yeah, I honestly wouldn't be surprised. Like I said, it was just such a strange story that I thought, you know, I kind of had to get it out there, but I kind of wanted to focus first more on the victims and the people who were directly kind of hurt by him. And in the second episode, I talk about somebody who was indirectly kind of accused of being the Beast of Jersey and how they had their lives pretty much ruined and destroyed by him. So I kind of wanted to focus on that and then get into kind of him later down the road, so to speak.
True crime seems to be a really, really fast-taking genre. Like, we've always had, like, unsolved mysteries and things like that, but going back to the 80s, I'm sure there's stuff before then, even. But lately, just, like, investigative discovery and other things like that. What is it about the macabre that fascinates us? What is it that draws us to this? Because people love eat this stuff up.
It's the taboo aspect of it, I think. And I think a lot of people are drawn to it because it's so unorthodox, so out of the ordinary. I come from a more boring, I guess, perspective on it because I was always very much into history, American history, European history, whatever it may be. I was fascinated by it. And growing up, I was always into the outlaws of the Wild West and the mobsters of the 30s and from the mafia in the 50s and the 60s and 70s. Growing up in Jersey and growing up in Lodi, I would hear a lot of stories from friends who said they knew guys who were in the life. And from there on, I just kind of shifted, I guess, into serial killers. But it's never a case, I think, with most people. You know, I can only answer for myself and why I'm interested. I kind of go from certainly, I guess, a darker point of view, but I'm also interested in the history of it, of the who, the where, the what, and why. Why at this time period, why the case happened, why it kind of turned out the way it did. And I know for a lot of people, there's also that, you know, from a young age, we're almost pumped with images of horror, be it through music, television, films, comic books, you name it, TV show, and it's so readily available out there that I think, you know, it's not like in the old days where you had to wait around for some kind of late night program. Now everything is a mouse click away. So I think a lot of time the information kind of grows and snowballs and passes on. The problem is that this also causes a lot of misinformation. I notice people repeat half truths or lies that have long bunked. So, you know, you take the good with the bad, I suppose.
You got, you're wrapping up the Beast of Jersey. Episode 2 just dropped this previous Monday, if I'm not mistaken. Part 3 coming up soon. What do you cover after this?
Well, after this, I have actually 3 planned topics. I have really planned ahead. Next episode, after I'm done with the Beast of Jersey, is going to be something a little different. It's I'm going to be speaking to a man from Alabama who communicated with the British serial killer Dennis Nilsson. And communicated with him for a good few years, writing letters, exchanging letters with him back and forth. And Dennis Nilsson is really popular now because recently a British TV show starring David Tennant of Doctor Who fame premiered, and it kind of got a lot of people talking. So I thought this might be a good time to tap into the mainstream. And it's actually one of the subjects of the book I'm writing about that I'll be talking about. The other is a case in Germany that I'm working with a friend of mine to see if I can do a bit of more research on it. So I have some interesting things planned. I don't want to cover, you know, Bundy, Dahmer, Gacy, and all those guys, because, you know, they've had everything from podcasts to movies to Dahmer versus Gacy movies, you know. So it's like, I have nothing of value to add anymore.
Where do you stand on Richard Ramirez, the Night Stalker?
You know, not a particularly pleasant guy, and not somebody.
I asked because that was the big boogeyman when I was growing up. I was so young that when he was in the common knowledge, like they showed that wanted sketch of his, I didn't really know the difference between like a photo and a sketch. So I thought that was the legitimate Night Stalker, just this weird dude that's just an outline, kind of got a glow about him. But yeah, that motherfucker's like creeping into my window. Again, I'm 5'6" at the oldest, so you know we don't understand everything necessarily. We think He-Man's also a real guy wandering. But I just wonder where he might be on your queue.
Ramirez is a case that I'm quite familiar with. But again, because it's been kind of done to death, explored, talked about, delved into, I don't give it as much attention as I would, like I said, because he's part of that echelon of the big names. And I'm interested in the cases that are kind of a little bit more to the wayside, because I find there's more rewarding material, and sometimes you'll find people who are willing to talk about it. Mm-hmm. As for Ramirez himself, yes, you know, I'm not the big popular band. I'm the smaller band that like three people only care about, you know, because they're not very good, maybe. But hey, maybe they got like a song or two that's, you know, and I don't know this, and I'm not trying to do it like, oh, look at me, I'm so out of the mainstream, look at how cool and chic I am, you know. It's not that. It's just it's, as a historian, what I like to do. Like, I can't think of anything more fun than sitting over old court documents from the 20s and 30s, and, you know, like, that's my idea of a good time. I'm sorry, you know. And I just like reading and sharing some of this stuff, maybe overly sharing sometimes, but it's what I like to do. But as for Ramirez himself, as I told somebody else, the quintessential edgelord. I mean, anybody who carves a pentagram into their hand and says, you know, see you in Disneyland is like definitely ink for that edgelord demographic.
All right. Episodes drop every other week?
Try to do them every two, every 3 weeks. Okay. A lot of kind of research goes into it. And then I have a pretty hectic schedule with where I work, so I don't always have enough time.
Go for that quality.
But I'm trying to make more time now with, you know, everything kind of going on in the world.
Mm-hmm. Is it only available on YouTube, or can we find them on iTunes and Google Play and etc.?
As of right now, it's only on my YouTube channel, One More Story Before 12. But after the third episode drops, I'm going to come through and release it. It's this big two and a half hour block on Spotify.
Oh, far out.
All right.
So, okay. Again, I'm not doing this for like any money or anything. It's more of like, you know, hey, if somebody can get some kind of information and interest out of this, I hope it helps.
Project's a project, my man.
Oh, hell yeah. It's some great shit. It's very interesting. I've always really enjoyed learning about kind of real life scary shit. I watch a lot of Forensic Files because it's just always on. If you like the Forensic Files, you will like this One More Story Before 12 podcast.
I was definitely interested in like how much detail you did go into, and I was like, so yeah, so you're getting two thumbs up here on this side. Let's lighten the mood a little bit. Robyn, you got a game for us today?
We have a brand new edition, a special edition of Robyn Seto's Cameo Party.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Some music here.
Beep, beep,
beep,
there we
beep,
go.
Robyn Seto's Cameo Party. Robyn Seto's Cameo Party.
So this is special
cameo party. What do you got for us today, Robyn? What's the word?
This is our special spooky edition of the cameo party. Mm-hmm. So what I've done this week is I've gone onto Cameo and I've searched specifically for horror related actors on here, and I think it will be pretty fun for us to do. Mm-hmm.
And for those joining us for the first time, break down the rules, Robyn Seto.
All right, so it's basically Price is Right rules. We want to get as close as we can to the price without going over. So I have four here. If there's a tie, we'll have a tiebreaker.
Exciting.
And yeah, well, it's so. Yes, the prices range from $1,000 to like $5,000. So there's your range.
Wow.
To guess from. Wow. That's all of Cameo, not this specific round, just all of Cameo.
I just want to say, for when we started doing the Robyn Seto Cameo Party, like, something happened where the minimum bid you could find was like $20. So since the last 6 weeks, somebody has lowballed the hell out of themselves all the way down to $1 is what I'm hearing.
Yeah, like I went and I searched, and you can sort the actors by price, and there's people all the way down to like $1. It's pretty sad.
That's amazing.
And of course, I don't.
I remember in a previous episode, you guys mentioned that Bob Saget was doing Cameo, and when I heard what he was charging, I was so upset with Bob Saget because I read his book and he's so open-hearted and altruistic. And then I heard what he's charging and I thought, this is despicable, Bob Saget. He should be ashamed of himself.
I never did any extra research on that, but I want to say he's that dude who's like going to give it all to some sort of charity. But don't quote me on that. He may just be like sitting on bags of Cameo money now, just like Scrooge McDuck. Like, it's all mine.
No, I love Bob Saget, but like just like John Lovitz, like never kind of pass up an opportunity to just kind of, you know, shit on.
All right. So let's get this party started. Coming at us first. The Shining Twins, and that's what they're listed on in Cameo as the Shining Twins.
The sad thing is that I almost had a chance to meet the Shining Twins because they were at a horror convention I was at back in 2014. And they were $100. Like it wasn't super expensive, or it might have been even lower than that, but I'm going, you know, off of a 6-year memory, but I'm going to say 100 for their Cameo.
100.
Okay. Well, Mike's got 100.
I
have never seen The Shining all the way through, much like Jaws. I know about it through cultural osmosis. So I know of the twins. I read the book back in middle school. Book was incredibly scary. That and Cujo were like the only things that like actually shook me. As far as anything horror-wise goes. I have never thought about the Shining Twins, but they would actually have like some sort of cult of personality following. Dare I even say there'd be some sort of fetish about the Shining Twins. Just some sort of weird, like...
Oh, yeah, twins.
yeah, the whole twins gimmick. So, The Shining, huge cult classic. Jack Nicholson, Shelley Duvall... Obviously, my man Kubrick. This movie has documentaries about it on just theories about crazy shit that went into this movie. Having said that, The Shining Twins, I'm going to say they're charging $250 a pop.
$250, okay.
Or $250 total, excuse me.
For The Shining Twins, well, for $125, you can get a Shining Twins Cameo.
Wow, that seems like a discount.
Right, twofer.
They went up a little bit.
75 of a pop.
Right. All right, moving on. We have one. Linnea Quigley Cameo.
Oh, she's like from like Return of...
Naked Return of the Living Dead. I want to get torn apart by old men.
This is what my life's knowledge is, just, you know, accumulating all this great, you know, useless trivia and information that I learned from conventions. Linnea Quigley was actually gone up in price from what I remember. I said a friend of mine paid, I want to say about 200.
Oh,
200? Yeah, that's what I'm going to go for a Cameo. Like, she's one of those, I guess, screen queen legends at this point, and I know that she can charge quite a bit. I'd say 200.
200? Okay. I think that's a good price. Like, Linnea Quigley, I didn't know in name until maybe a couple of years ago on Red Letter Media when they did a review on it. I had only seen Return of the Living Dead maybe less than a decade ago now. And I've always seen the box in the video store. And it was just something that never came up until a woman we were dating was like, we're watching this tonight. I was like, okay. When we get to Linnea Quigley's dance number, I just looked over at my future fiance and I went, I totally get why people like this, because she's just full frontal, bare wax. Like, Linnea Quigley, she is revolutionary, groundbreaking. She's a trendsetter.
$201. $201, okay. Well, for $100, $100, you can get a Linnea Quigley Cameo.
I feel like that's a huge discount.
Bust. Point goes to Mike. Moving on. We have Nick Castle, who played the original Mike Myers in Halloween.
Okay, Nick Castle. tweet guy. I think he actually had some kind of cameo in the newest one. I don't remember in what scene. Nick Castle's great because with age, he's just kind of gotten smaller. And he's rocking this great 70s stash. And he's always sipping on his Coke, you know?
Oh, yeah.
He's such a sweet guy because he's like, he's always so bemused that all I did was just I put on a mask and I did some water. Like, I'm not an active. Of course, he doesn't talk like that. I don't know why he sounds like, Wilford Brimley or something when I do that voice. But Nick Castle, he was charging $75 last I remember. Mm-hmm. So right, I would do somewhere around that price range, $75.
Okay. All right.
$75. I've never heard of Nick Castle. And before Michael gave us the information he did give, I would have imagined he had the same cult following as a Kane Hodder. Mm-hmm. However, Kane Hodder, not the first Jason in the Friday the 13th franchise. He's the third or the fourth. But you never hear about the first Jason that much. So I wouldn't believe we would hear much about the first Michael Myers. As you just tell us, he seems like a very humble guy. I'm going to say $50. I'm going to say he's reflecting on the COVID happening here. He knows everyone's not working exactly. He still needs to get some money, so he'll take anything he can. So he's giving everyone a discount, $50 for Michael Myers for Nick Castle.
All right. Okay. Well, four. Exactly, $75. You can get in a Castle cameo.
What?
Wow!
Wow!
You did it.
Oh.
You got it. He done it.
I'm in shock. First game I've won in my entire life.
Yay!
Did it! Yay!
Robyn Seto's cameo party.
So that was our party.
That was the Robyn Seto cameo party.
Yeah. Yeehaw. We done this.
Congratulations to Michael Bajer. You can find him on YouTube at One More Story Before 12. Is there a Twitter account? Is there a Facebook link, Mike?
That's all. Just a YouTube account. I'm trying to keep it as low key for now, you know, before.
Subscribe, like, hit the bell, all that shit. One More Story Before 12. Current story, Beast of Jersey. It's a creepy one. I suggest if you've never heard of it, investigate it. Robyn Seto, what are you doing on the network these days?
On the network these days, I'm doing a little beer reviews called Polite Beer Reviews. Those go up on Wednesdays. And every week I do a little bit of a fluffy piece on some different craft beer. They're fun, quick, easy reads, and they're just fun and informational.
And Robyn Seto enjoys her craft beer. So far, the lowest review she's given is a 4 out of 5. So if you pop up on this, you're probably gonna have a good day. So Robyn Seto loves her craft beer. Kush Hayes, you can find me on Twitter at Kush_Hayes. I don't do much there, but sometimes I do movie reviews. You can find those on TheBosNet.family. I've been Kush Hayes for Michael Bajer. Robyn Seto, who are you? Outstanding.
We did it.
Cyclone, we did it.
My man Junior on the motherfucking beat with some straight at me.
Kush Hayes Show. Kush Hayes Show. The Kush Hayes Show.
The Kush Hayes Show. Microdose.
The Bosnet family.
You know, not a particularly pleasant guy. And not so much.